Well, if you know Rudolf Steiner's work, every second paragraph is contradicting the paragraph before it. And that's not random. That is the very mark of the teaching in the mystery stream. It's called macrocosmic initiation. In microcosmic initiation, you have one teacher who teaches you the way his teacher taught him. And you better do it right. And in the process of that teacher correcting you again and again and again, eventually you end up running into your own inability in your soul to learn something, and you have a microcosmic unfolding that you contain the whole world. That's called microcosmic initiation. And when you do, you usually decide you need a new master. Because now your consciousness has expanded beyond the teaching. And your master will tell you, that's not the way my master taught it. And you will say, excuse me, sir, but this is my experience. And that experience is pointing towards the different mystery school, the macrocosmic school, where you have many different teachers teaching you from their point of view, and their teachings conflict with each other. And they don't care, because it's their teaching that they have had to work through their own conflicting teachings that were given to them in order to arrive at their philosophy of life. And a life lived without a philosophy of life is not a life lived. It's just plant the corn, watch it grow, drink the beer, and die. Of the macrocosmic process, we're teaching that the only way to get an answer is by not knowing something. It's called the initiation of unknowing, the cloud of unknowing, the path of unknowing. And the goal in the path of unknowing is to tolerate questions that are not answered. That is the goal. And it requires a very strong sense that even though I do not know, I know that when I need to know, I will know. Even though I do not know, I'm strong enough in myself to know that when I need to know, that will be provided for me. That's called macrocosmic initiation. Because then I find out of all of the phenomena of the world, I find myself. And that is the path of Christian Rosenkreuz as an esoteric teacher, according to Rudolf Steiner. And the path of Christian Rosenkreuz was, you need to understand the science and philosophy of your day as best as you can. It doesn't mean you have to be a scientist. It doesn't mean you have to be a philosopher. But you have to learn how to think. If you don't learn how to think, there is no way for you to tolerate ambiguity. And the future, in case you haven't observed this already, will be huge amounts of ambiguity. That's called news cycles. every second day, somebody else was the perpetrator. Oh, yeah, well, we thought it was the perpetrator yesterday, but we found out some evidence showed that it was this one, but in his backpack he had this, and we, you know, and people are just can't wait for the next little data bit of news in order that they have the feeling like they understand something. And in the end, it's like, what? So the future is much more ambiguity. And if we're put off by small ambiguity, it's going to be a rough road to hoe. Because everything will be ambiguous. But there is a saying of the mystery teachers, higher truth can only be expressed through paradox. Lower truth has definite answers. But higher truth requires living in unknowing for extended periods of time without blaming oneself for not knowing. This is a critical issue in the mystery school. Because the humans now are going to be faced with totally conflicting false data. Yesterday I mentioned that a Twitter hack that lost $2 billion on the stock market in 2 minutes. Wait and see what happens with information. When the tiniest little bit of programmed misinformation will start a snowball rolling, that will take a little bit of coming back with. So that is where we're going. It's not going to go back to, living in teepees and chasing the deer around. Although we dearly would love that to be the case. But it's not going to go there. So Christian Rosenkreutz, as a teacher, his first prerogative was think. Learn how to think. Meaning, learn how to put things in order in your thinking, even though you know that tomorrow that order may change. It doesn't matter if it changes. If it changes, you're probably doing a good job. If what you thought you knew yesterday was forever, you would not be learning. So the tolerating of not knowing is the second step. The first step is learn how to think. The second step is learn how to think without thoughts. I know, it's crazy, but that's... So thinking without thoughts is forming pictures that I put in order and then dissolving them. Christian Rosenkreutz came and told his students, you need to take images from nature and you need to watch the way phenomena unfold in nature. You need to put a seed and watch the green part come out and the root and then a leaf, and not only watch it, but duplicate the pictures that you saw inwardly out of your own will. So last night in my presentation, I gave many pictures. And the purpose of giving pictures is so that you can take pictures into sleep rather than words. If you try to take words into sleep, you get congested because there are no nouns in the realm of the dead, said Rudolf Steiner. There's only activities. There are no things. There are only becomings. So we do an exercise based on the teachings of Christian Rosenquist. I call it will glasses, will spectacles. We live in a world of magic, technical magic, like that column or the wall or the floor. And we walk on the floor, we walk by the column, we have no way to know how it was made. But everything that was made, was made. And Christian Rosenquist came back to teach people how to participate in that inwardly. So I have to take something that I don't quite understand and form in my mind's eye a sequence of pictures of how I think it came into being. So if you listen to a lecture, don't listen to the words, listen to the pictures. The pictures are not in any language. They are transcendent. And the pictures have a much deeper flexibility that I can arrange them in many different ways and get many different meanings. I can look through the windows of the mansion and see many different points of view. If I think in pictures, if I think in words, then I should probably become a lawyer. Because the purpose of a lawyer is to limit meanings to this word means this. The purpose of a poet is to expand multiple meanings for one word. The mystery school that Rudolf Steiner came back out of the impulse of Christian Rosenquist is to make poetry, to make conversare, to make verses with each other rather than have discussion. Cus, cutere, to chop up into little pieces. And dis is the ancient name for the god Pluto, the god of hell. So discussion means I take what you say, I chop it into little pieces, and I send it to hell. Conversation means let's make some verses with each other. So when I make a verse with you, I don't know when you're going to change the next word. When I have a discussion with you, I'm sure that the last word you used was not the right one. Can you feel the difference? The heart recognizes conversation. The head is into discussion. So thinking with my heart, conversare, means I arrange pictures in particular orders and I can change the order to see if I get a different meaning. So I take something in my life that I think I understand with my mind and I try to picture it as a process of, with my will glasses, how was this made? So there's a beautiful stone wall in the back here, a field stone. I can imagine workers in a field gathering the stone and then bringing it in wheelbarrows and setting it up and laying it up and putting mortar, I imagine the will activity, the social will activity to build the wall, I imagine that in my mind's eye in a three-step process. A, B, C. They bring the stone in, they set it up with mortar, and then they build the scaffolding up. I picture that in my mind's eye. And what I'm doing is participating in the spiritual development of the social will that's behind the world. I was in England not too long ago lecturing, and I talked about will glasses, and I got an email from a woman afterwards. She was in a train station. She was going up to the north of England. And just in the waiting for people to get on and off, she happened to look out the window, and there were all these field stones laid, thousands of them, in this train station to make this brick wall. So she put her will glasses on and watched while all the workers made this wall. Her heart opened up in gratitude. It was like, who were these people who did all this work for me? This is the teaching of Christian Rosenkreuz, to open the heart to the social will. I knew a chemistry teacher that was having problems with his ninth grade class. He was trying to bring some lessons. They were going in the back room in the storeroom and breaking the glassware. So in a fit of anger, he said to them, "I'll bet you don't even know how a test tube is made." And then he realized, "God, I don't know how a test tube is made." I'll get back to you on that one. So he went home, and he went online and spent the evening having revelation of how a test tube is made. It's remarkably sophisticated technology. And then he tried to make some himself. Had great respect for the people to make a test tube. After he had assimilated the will that is behind the test tube, then he went in and told a story to his class out of his own will experience how the test tube was made. And they were amazed. No more broken glassware. And then some smart one in the back said, "Well, how do they make beakers?" There's another adventure, but that's some mind that is awakening now to the social will. So the picture language of exploring the world as it exists, not as a fait accompli, but as a becoming, as an activity. How do I translate the deadness of my world into a livingness of social sacrifice for each other? I had an experience one time in a shopping center. I went in to buy something, and I was waiting in line, and there was a senior, older woman with a little shopping cart, very shaky, and she pushed her shopping cart up to the check stand, and I was there behind her. And with shaking hands, she picked up a box of spaghetti and went to